Maybe? So once again, to mention this power of individual story that show actually a systematic problem. It was a tool used by the pro-abortion movement in Poland to help to destigmatize abortion and bring the arguments of safe, legal and free abortion for all. As you can imagine, it is very important, very difficult in a country like this, because Poland is a conservative country, so to talk about abortion is already very difficult, is considered a taboo. And through these individual stories, through showing what story of a particular woman, why she did it, and what was her way to do this, it bring this to the audience, and people started to openly debate about that. And on the other hand, through these individual stories, through showing how precarious women are actually forced sometimes to decide how they're forced to actually do the abortions because of their economical conditions. Through these individual stories, they could also bring anti-capitalist arguments for why the abortion should be actually covered by health insurance. And it is also very difficult in Poland, in a country when the support for capitalist system is also so huge. And so the power of individual stories in the activist movement is, I guess, very important. And then I have another story for a question for the French comrade. You've been talking about a lot about the inequality in the healthcare system. I think it's very important to talk about that. How strong is the debate about inequality in healthcare system in France? Because and can you mobilize a movement with this topic?
Pronto. Io volevo fare una domanda, che è un po' una domanda di un punto teorico che noi molte volte all'università estiva e non solamente qua abbiamo cercato di mettere a tema, che è il punto sul lavoro di cura. Voi l'avete affrontato dal punto di vista delle narrazioni e anche delle cifre che ci ha dato la compagna francese, no? Ma come dire, a me piacerebbe porre una domanda di un punto di condivisione di un momento teorico che è nelle mobilitazioni dell'8 marzo, in particolare in Spagna, è risolto con un'allusione del modo di organizzare la piazza, no? Quando si fa lo sciopero in Spagna e poi gli uomini sono invitati a stare all'atto, ma in particolare sono invitati a occuparsi della cura, praticamente si allude a una divisione del lavoro che se fosse cambiata nella società e anche nella famiglia, renderebbe la vita più facile. E questo significa delle rivendicazioni generali, significa un salario per tutti e tutte e una diminuzione dell'orario di lavoro. Ecco, è come se ci fosse sempre l'intuizione di un cambiamento importante e poi non fossimo capaci di mettermi a tema con rivendicazioni generali per tutta Europa. Le rivendicazioni andrebbero bene per tutti, anche per i paesi come la Scandinavia e la Danimarca, che sono avanzati dal punto di vista dello stato sociale. Però, come dire, la divisione del lavoro tra uomo e donna non è significativamente cambiata, tant'è vero che mi sembra che, per esempio, il congedo di paternità, noi in Italia lo chiamiamo così, l'Italia è preso da pochi, non so in quanti paesi c'è, da noi viene preso soprattutto nel pubblico impiego e chi lo prende, diciamo, è visto piuttosto, è posto sotto grande ironia, diciamo così, da parte dei colleghi. E chiaro che cioè, c'è molto lavoro da fare in tutta Europa, nel nord e nel sud.
Tout à l'heure, je vous disais en fait l'importance de. Alors, je suis très. Vraiment, je suis d'accord avec la camarade Lucas sur le fait que, après avoir discuté, il faut passer à l'action, il faut retourner sur le terrain. Moi, je suis convaincue que, avant d'aller sur le terrain, il faut d'abord théoriser les choses et être d'accord en fait sur les concepts. Mettre les mots, les bons mots sur les bonnes réalités, c'est très important. Et sur ces questions-là et sur les enjeux nouveaux, notamment pour les droits des femmes, c'est très important aussi qu'on se réunisse et que déjà, en fait, la première étape, c'est de regagner l'unité. La gauche est divisée, à la fois dans mon pays et à la fois en Europe. Les féministes sont également divisées sur certains sujets et on a besoin vraiment de s'unir de nouveau pour se dire on travaille ensemble, on avance ensemble et on ramène en fait au plus de monde. Ensuite, la seconde chose, c'est que pour moi, la question du féminisme et des droits des femmes, elle concerne également les hommes et les hommes ont à gagner des droits nouveaux également contre l'austérité et contre le capitalisme à enjoindre les causes féministes. Sur le congé parental en général, par exemple, le sujet, c'est que c'est quelque chose de très sexiste également. Il y a toujours, alors il y a des pays où ça n'existe pas, et les pays où ça existe, les femmes ont toujours plus de congés que les hommes. Alors que tout le monde aurait à gagner que ce soit un congé qui soit égal et qui soit pris voilà, au moment où on a envie de le prendre. Et simplement, je pense que quand on n'est pas féministe, pour moi on est sexiste, et on fait le jeu et du capitalisme et des partis de droite et d'extrême droite et des politiques austéritaires. Parce que ces droits nouveaux à gagner pour les femmes, et je me répète un peu, mais je le disais tout à l'heure, mais c'est important de le répéter, évidemment qu'il y a encore des choses nouvelles à gagner sur l'interruption volontaire de grossesse. Nous, on a eu un amendement là qui a été retoqué pour faire passer le recours de délai à l'IVG de 12 à 14 semaines. Ce n'est pas passé et ce n'est pas suffisant alors qu'on manque justement de centres de santé pour pouvoir aller avorter. On manque de personnel qui nous pratique les IVG. Les médecins sont en droit de refuser de pratiquer l'IVG avec la clause de conscience. Et ça se passe en France en 2019. Les sages-femmes n'ont pas le droit de pratiquer les IVG instrumentales. Et donc tous ces sujets-là, évidemment, qu'il y a encore des choses à gagner, etc. Et c'est pour ça que c'est important en fait, qu'on s'unisse à la fois dans tous les pays et qu'on voit en fait qu'on mette en place pourquoi pas une clause de l'Europe la plus favorisée et qu'on voit sur chaque droit où la femme italienne ou finlandaise ou espagnole qui a gagné un droit et qu'on puisse ensuite le porter nous chez nous dans nos pays et que qu'on s'explique les unes et les autres comment on a réussi en fait à gagner ces droits-là, mais ça ne peut pas passer autrement que par la discussion.
Okay, so the first question was why is the situation in Slovenia so bad if we have good laws and good constitution? What I wanted to show in my presentation is that there is a huge gap between the women who are like employed in a public system, who have regular jobs, and precarious women. The people who are employed have a lot of workers' rights, and women have good condition to go to the maternity leave. But they are still dealing with the with different sorts of problems. But the self-employed people, they don't have a good position. So if a same self-employed person gets sick in Slovenia, they get the money from the country after 1 month of the sickness. The women who are self-employed, they get around 200 euros per month when they are on the maternity leave. And basically, we don't talk about that kind of problems. So the good constitution and good laws are sometimes an excuse not to speak about the problem with the precarious workers, because we want to imagine that we live in a society which is open, which is progressive. For example, two stories came to my mind when I was thinking about these differences between the women who are employed and the women who are like self-employed. We were speaking with them about the importance of the kindergarten. And women who are employed said that they were really happy when their kids went to the kindergarten because they had free time, they could start to work, and they got their personal life back. But women who are in precarious position said to us, do you know what is the best thing? In kindergarten, my kid gets 8 free diapers per day. And that means that I don't need to spend 15 euros per week on diapers. So this is this like division. And then there was the question about the position of women in Yugoslavia and in Slovenia. I personally don't have the experience of life in Yugoslavia, but I was doing a research on abortion and I was asking women what were the practices when they have an abortion in Yugoslavia and in Slovenia. And in Yugoslavia, the doctors were really friendly and respectful. So the process was free, the process was transparent, and women didn't have like any troubles with it, mostly. But now in Slovenia, when I was speaking with the women, they said that even though we have the right to abortion written in the constitution, and the abortion is free, as in Yugoslavia, the way the doctors are treating the women changed. For example, they are saying to them, keep the baby, or you are the killer, and people are having prayers in front of the hospital. So I think this is like the best, this is the case that shows the difference in a really good way. So there is a huge difference in practices that are like dealing with the women, and also a lot of reproductive rights and a lot of rights are trying to be cut off. So all the time we have to fight to maintain the tradition of the socialism. So the subjective and objective relationship with the people that you work with. I'm an anthropologist, so I'm basically dealing with this question also all the time. And what I think is that you cannot escape from that kind of relationship. I am a white woman that is coming from a middle class, and I cannot pretend to them that I'm living their story. So I think what is the best you can do is to ask them and to talk. And what we are trying to do in the institute is to explain to them that this is not just an academic research. We are basically developing different laws, we are developing different suggestions to change their lives, and we can do this just with their help. So they are an important and equal partner in this process. And with that kind of approach, we gain trust and people are working with us. And what is also, I think, important is that you don't pretend, that you don't try to be equal. Like, I'm all the time explaining to them, you need to speak with me because I don't know anything about this stuff and you are helping me here, basically. The question about the trade unions. In Slovenia, the trade unions are like a huge partner when it is coming to the workers' rights. Slovenia became independent in the 90s, and there was like a huge question what to do with the constitution in regards to abortion. And then at that time, this amazing movement happened in Slovenia when women from different political parties, from the right-wing parties, from the left parties, organized themselves and said, we will fight for the right to choose, we will fight for the right to abort. And the first people they called were the trade unions. So basically they are a huge help there. And 3 years ago, the government wanted to cut the free contraception pills in Slovenia, and the trade unions were the first that noticed this and were the persons that helped to organize the protest. But on the other hand, in the trade unions there is a huge problem of chauvinism. There is a huge problem that mostly men are working there, and women who are working for the trade unions are trying to have a fight about the salaries. What they discover is that the women in the trade unions are paid less than men, and they want to address it. They also want to put the equal pay as one of the main fights of the trade unions, but this suggestion doesn't go through the leadership of the trade unions. Then there was the question about the connection with the feminism and with the politics that exist. I think that here is one huge problem that social democrats and liberal parties are also claiming themselves to be feminist. And I think that they're even better in publicly explaining this and using this as a part of their campaigning strategy. So what we can do is to explain the differences between the feminism. And what I'm always saying is that a person who is against migrants, a person who is for the quotas but is for the company that is paying cheap labor, cheap labor in China, is not a feminist. Basically, this is just a person who wants women to be in the position of the power as well, but this is not a feminism. And then, for the power of the personal stories, I think that also one of the problems of the left is that people don't understand what we are saying. My personal experience is that my grandmother is a huge fan of the left. But sometimes she says to me, Nika, can you explain this? Like, what are they doing now in the parliament? What is the party doing? Because we are using, like, really academic language, which is okay. We need to have the academia and we have to think about our suggestions, but we need to know how to explain this to the people. And personal stories are a great way of explaining them. In Slovenia, we had this problem with the fiscal rule 4 years ago. It was written in the constitution at the end, but there was a huge problem because people didn't know what the fiscal rule is, and we were like all trying to find the personal stories that are affected with that kind of rule. For example, also the Brexit campaign, whatever we think about the Brexit, the problem with the campaign to remain in the European Union was just the fact that their spokesperson just talked about the numbers and about the profit and about the economic, and the other side was speaking about the real life. So we are mostly forgetting about the real life experience and about the impact that the politics have on real people. And then at the end, I also agree that if we are doing feminism, we have to do it all of us together. It is not a movement of the woman, it is a movement of men, women, transgender people and everyone else, and this is, like, I think, the most important message when we fight.
And then I will say thank you to Sophia and Julia. Yeah,